predestination is something that most people have no clue about. The one thing that sets Christianity, true Christianity, apart from anything else, is that our destiny finds its way to us. There's nothing more debilitating than to doubt deep in your heart whether or not God's going to bring you through to the finish line. And Satan's main job is to cause you to doubt that. He causes you to doubt that because, in general, most of us have a great deal of positive perspective when it comes to what we can do. But when it comes to what God can do, it seems like people are increasingly putting divine things and supernatural intervention on the back burner. And I think that may be because a lot of them never see supernatural intervention or see the Holy Ghost at operation in their day-to-day lives, changing things that ordinarily could not be changed. Now, there's another reason that undercurrent for that is I think people in general, even in the body of Christ, church going people, never mind denomination they may be. I'm not a real fan of denominations. I believe there's only one true body of Christ. I believe there's only one kingdom of God. I believe there's only one Savior, one Lord, one Holy Ghost, one Father, one Son. I believe truthfully that the body of Christ is the church. And therefore, the body of Christ is the church. If you are a part of the body of Christ, then you can call yourself part of the church. To call yourself a Christian can mean anything. You know, I mean, you can yell God is great and kill somebody, and a lot of people wouldn't understand, well, how could a Christian do that? They're not Christian. Because Christians come to impart life, not to take it. Now, when you think about Christianity and its ability to give you hope in things that other people can't hope for, the reason for that is the ability to hope beyond the natural is in fact a spiritual strength. The more we develop that spiritual strength, the more we can call it faith. The world has faith in itself. Before you were born again, before you understood true Christianity, you had faith in yourself too. Because most of us were raised to think, if I'm going to get there, I'm going to get there by my own strength. Or if you're a con man or a crook or a liar, do it on the backs of other people. But either way, you had a desire in your heart to do something with your life, and it depended upon you getting there to do it. Now, we've taken that and welcomed it into the church dogma, into the doctrine of Jesus Christ. Somehow, we've managed to incorporate the fact that God will do it for you only when you've exhausted all your own strength. And it's far from the truth. Because what that does is it debilitates faith. It weakens it to the point where if you can't see it happen by your own strength or power, by then you may be so under the whole process that you give up on yourself, you give up on God, you give up on everything. The greatest amount of prescriptions today that are being written for antidepressants. We call them mind-altering drugs. Morphic drugs, which change the way that the brain actually functions and alters the secretions into the brain, for a general term, that cause you to think the way you think and act the way you act. More children today in schools are on some form of a Ritalin-type program to shut them up and keep them quiet because they're dysfunctional to begin with, and if they try to voice that or make that understood to somebody in whichever way they can, some of them are off the hook, some of them just cry a lot, then the immediate response to that is, let's just shut them up so at least we can manage them. Well, aren't you glad that people don't do that with newborn babies? Otherwise, they'd all starve to death. But there's a lot of people that are, you know, very uncomfortable about coming into a ministry environment, and I understand that. I'm uncomfortable in a lot of ministry environments myself. But one thing I can promise you, that if you're looking for answers, sooner or later, God will get those answers to you. Where everything becomes so important that you'll discover that nothing is that important. What's he saying? What I'm saying is that once we determine how to please God, God's job then is to get us to the place that he designed us for in the first place. Now, in order to do that, I'm going to target in on a couple of scriptures. I want them in the back room if you can dial into Jeremiah chapter 1, and then I'm going to bounce up to Jeremiah 18, and after that, probably two or three other places as well. And what are we going to talk about? Well, I thought today we might discuss the whole idea of destiny or predestination, and whether in fact it's a biblical stance, and also the sovereignty of God. What is sovereignty? And if we can get a handle on the sovereignty of God, it will bring us to a place, just happened to come this way, of serenity, of peace. And more than anything else, whenever the Lord walked into a room, especially after the resurrection, and showed himself alive to his disciples and to many others before he was taken up into the clouds, we believe that because our faith tells us it is so. He made the statement, peace be unto you. In the midst of storms, he came saying, peace, peace, peace. Walking through walls, that'll freak you out. When the disciples looked at him, saw him walking on the water, they cried out, it's got to be some kind of apparition. It's a ghost, some kind of a weird thing. And he said, peace. It is I. Now, I guess he thought that fixed the disciples up. I don't know if it had fixed me up or not. But nevertheless, he came to them and revealed himself in a new dimension to them. Now, here in the book of Jeremiah, who had the hand on him before, hand of God on him before he was even birthed, reading the first probably three or four verses, if you wouldn't mind, if you'd stick that up on the screen for me. And then we're going to go to chapter 18, I think. Anyway, it says, the words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests who were in Anoth in the land of Benjamin. Next verse there. To whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. Most important fact there to realize is that the word of the Lord came to him. Next verse. It came also in the days of Jeroboam and the son of Josiah, the king of Judah, at the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, blah, 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 the son of Josiah, the king of Judah, until the carrying away of Jerusalem captive in the 5th month. Next verse. Then the word of the Lord came to me, saying, whenever God spoke to Jeremiah, he always prefaces that by saying, then the word of the Lord came to me. Something was interjected into the life of Jeremiah, and the voice of God, when that did come, changed the history of that nation. Next verse. He says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Now, you're very familiar with this passage of Scripture, but you know I'm going to take you places maybe you haven't seen before. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I sanctified you, and I ordained you a prophet to the nations. Now, that's very obviously saying, it's a predestining statement. Before you were born, I formed you in the womb. I knew you before you were born. Something was going on in the womb of Jeremiah's mother that had God involved in it. Amen? And the thing that was going on in him was that God said, I'm going to separate you and make you a prophet under the nations. One more verse. Listen to verse 6. Then God said, ah, God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am just a young man. Next verse 7. And these are all preliminary statements to help you understand where I'm going today. But the Lord said to me, don't say I am a youth, for you shall go to all whom I send you, and whatever I command you, you will speak. Now understand that the formation of a ministry, or the formation of a prophet in this case, the same process is still involved today. And whether or not you're in full-time ministry or whether or not you've discovered that God has promised each and every one of us who are born again a destination, a place in which we will reach where our fulfillment will be found. For many people in the world, indeed before I was born again, I did a lot of stuff, a lot of it bad, a lot of it not so bad, some of it pretty bad. But the bottom line of all of that was, of course, that I didn't know God. And so whatever I did, said, whoever I hurt, it was all justified because that's what I wanted to do. There was no consideration or even fleeting thought that something that I could do might help somebody unless it was in my own benefit to do so. There's a process, however, that takes place that we're going to discover today, that from the time someone has been birthed, a newborn baby, that baby has two destinies. It has one that God had ordained for the child and one that God did not ordain for the child. both of which are determined by whether or not that child's spirit is reunited with the God who created that spirit. I think for us to understand, you know, sovereignty, I've got a definition here that I scribbled out that I'll give to you just because it's nice to know. When people talk about sovereignty, they need to understand the purposes by which God does things. The word sovereign actually comes from a word, which I obviously can't find where I scribbled it. Doesn't matter. I remember it. It comes from a word, a Latin word, which means of supra, from which we get the word super or all-encompassing. It actually means one who has the head authority or power over all other powers. Supreme power. God is the only one that has supreme power, and therefore he, under the, a lot of the old films that you'll see when the king of a particular city walked through the streets, the peasants would bow down to the king because he was the one that had the power to take away their life. If you were to cross paths with someone who had the power to kill you or the power to be a blessing to you, you'd have to think twice before you walked around with your nose stuck up in the air, I think, yeah? When it comes to that, then God is sovereign, and therefore God is the one to whom those who recognize him as creator, and that's an act of faith which doesn't come until somebody is born again usually. That act of worship is, I've got my coat, don't worry, anybody bounce up here to grab it, thanks very much. That act of worship is an act of recognition of God and who he is. Sovereignty means that there is no other power above his. There are lots of powers underneath him, but there are none that are above him. Are you following me so far? If that's the case, then we don't have need to worry that if we are related to God by spirit, because God is spirit, until somebody's born again and their spirit's connected to God who is spirit, the process of directing you to where you are supposed to be at certain parts of your life, certain times and seasons of your life, which we, by the way, we usually miss. We're very poor on time, keeping time and keeping schedule. Knowing this, that in order to do the work of God in this dispensation and this season, you've got to have more than simply a casual belief that there is a divine being. You've got to get to a point where you believe, not only do I believe in divine beings, period, multiple beings that are divine, angels are divine beings, but there's also one who is ruler over all of them. You and I, as Christians, find ourselves citizens of a new kingdom, citizens with a new king, therefore a new set of rules and a new way of living. That new way of living takes us a long time to allow to take place. Jeremiah was a man who was called even before he was born, before he knew he was going to be Jeremiah. He knew that God knew that there was a call in his life and told him so. Now, I want you to skip over to chapter 18 for me, if you don't mind. It says, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, is another, see, I told you, every time Jeremiah gets a word, God gives him a heads up. He says, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about the potter's house because it has connotations that most people, I don't think, have seen. And the reason God told Jeremiah to go down to a little house of pottery where they were making pots and so forth and so on, cisterns, was that Jeremiah was having a great deal of difficulty in convincing Israel that they were on the wrong side of their walk with God. They had become a very rebellious people. They had become people who were welcoming all kind of false gods and witchcraft into their lives. And God always sent the prophets, under the Old Testament in particular, to try to correct or give people the opportunity to correct what they were doing, which was stopping God blessing them. And in this particular instance, Jeremiah wasn't having too much success. So God gave Jeremiah a word picture of what he was trying to accomplish. And in that word picture, you'll get an understanding, as I do, that the process by which God did this is the same process by which he works with you. In order to get any one of his Old Testament prophets to the place where that prophet believed in the absolute sovereignty of God to provide whatever, whenever, to whomever, provided that prophet could agree with God, there was nothing that God couldn't do on this planet. He would use the prophets to bring those things to pass. You listening? Before the prophet could be used in that capacity, he had to get to a place where God showed him and taught him that whatever he needed was also to be provided by a sovereign God. And if there was any lacking or any doubt in the heart of the prophet or the man of God concerning God's ability to do something, then he would be trained beyond that point so that he could impart that ability to believe God for provision, particularly to other people who needed it. God wanted to get answers to them. Now here, if he takes him down to the prophet's house, just wheel me back there for a second, and just stick with me. He says, arise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Well, his words in this case were sort of, you know, a little living parable. When you hear God saying words like that I'll cause you to hear my words, what he's really saying is, I want to show you so that you'll understand my words. And I think a lot of Christians are having that trouble today. We say we hear God, we read the word, but we still don't get it. And we still really don't trust God either. There are more Christians in debt today than ever before. And I think that's primarily because we have been trained, the church has been brainwashed, just like the world has, that unless you use the world system to get what we need or even sometimes what we want, we aren't going to get it. And then God comes in at the end of the tail mark of all that stuff, and finally we're crying out, oh God, what? See, unless we can get to ourselves and reverse that process, there's not going to be any faith on the earth when the Lord returns. Amen. Let's look at verse 3. He says, then I went down to the potter's house, and there he, that's the potter, of course, and potter, of course, is a type of God here, it's a metaphor of God, was making something at the wheel. Now, you know, whatever he was making at the wheel, it involved clay, and therefore we presume it was some kind of a vessel. All right? Now, hang on now. We'll head somewhere. So he says to the prophet, when you go down there, I'm going to show you what I'm doing. I'm the potter. And I'm going to show you what I'm doing on that wheel so that you'll understand why you're not having too much success getting people to believe you. You with me so far?
Yes.
All right. And he says, and the vessel that he made of clay, what did God originally make man with? Clay, dirt, right? And he says, he's talking here about the basic functionality of mankind. How I, as the potter, change the hearts of men and women to get them to where I want them to be, but more importantly, to get them to see where I want them to get to. Because where I want them to get to was formed as an option to them before they were even birthed. Only one faith and one God and one Savior and one Spirit promises that they can do exactly that. They can cause you to start at the wrong end of the stick and finish up owning the stick and the factory that made the stick.
Amen.
The reason that mentality is being bleached out of the gospel of the kingdom is because Satan knows that that mentality will destroy him. The mentality that any person can progress in their faith to a point where God is their provider, spirit, soul, body, financially, and in relationship. That is a difficult place to get to, and especially almost impossible to get to if you want to do it on your own strength. It has to involve faith. It has to involve something on the inside of me which keeps hanging on after everything else has fallen off. Something within each individual has to be stirred into recognition and then given authority and power in your life, and that one thing is your human spirit transferred by the Holy Ghost into something that is supernatural or divine. I believe that. I live that. And that's the reason I'm still standing here instead of under a drunken stupor somewhere under a coconut tree. The whole purpose of a man's calling or of a woman's calling is to discover God's purpose for him.
Yes.
Now, this is a very important thing. This is what I want to hit on today. Most Christians who love God are wearing themselves out trying to be something that God never called them to be. The second worst thing is they try to imitate somebody else who they think are successful in whatever else God's called them to do, and they burn themselves out that way. A prime one, if we ever had time to dissect it, would be Mary and Martha. There we go again, you see. Martha was accused by God of being worried about so many things. Mary has chosen the better part. The better part, of course, was listening to what the Master had to say rather than trying to impress the Master or work for the Master or do something that the Master would appreciate. It showed a basic weakness in Mary, not in Martha, in that particular sense. However, it says that Jesus, agape, he loved them with the love of God, which is the gift love. Doesn't require anything back. He loved Mary and Martha and her brother Lazarus. Loved them all, regardless of whether they were successful or not successful, because they were willing to listen to the instruction book as that went, Jesus' words in this case. Mary was way ahead of it. Martha was lagging behind. And Lazarus, let's face it, didn't bother him one way or the other because he was dead. Now, when we get to all of these processes, we start to figure out something, that God loves you, period. I mean, if we have to serve a God that only loves us when we're good, who can make it? I'm not good all the time. How about you? See, the word good is an English derivation of the word God. When it says that he was a good man, what they want to say in the Old Testament English was, or Old English was, he is a godly man or a God-fearing man. Amen? So I don't know about you, but I know that myself, I would fail if I had to, do everything right all the time, never make a mistake, that I would fall on the wrong side of the cross. I'd be trampled. Amen. So there'd be no way back for me. But I know and thank God for the fact that he was perfect, so I don't have to be. But I'd strive to please him. But you know, there are seasons in our life, my brothers and sisters, where everything you do is wrong. Would that come as a revelation to you? That there are times and seasons in every one of our lives where no matter how much we try to be good, we just be bad. We think wrong thoughts, we do wrong things, we upset people, we offend people, we criticize people. We've got nothing nice to say about anybody, and all of this time the Holy Spirit is sitting there listening to it. And somehow we make it through. It's like he must be like a linebacker, I guess. He must block a lot of the charges. I'm glad the quarterback gets through sometimes, All right. Well, anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that as we progress here, just in the next few minutes that I have with you, I want you to start thinking more about the immutability of God and his sovereignty and less about your inequalities. Because thinking about your inequalities is Satan's first job, isn't it? To plant the thought, hath God said. The thought has to be planted in your mind that there is more that I can get. Now listen to this, because it underlines the whole of what I want to talk about. It underlines the thought process that there is much more that I can accomplish, even as a Christian or a follower of Christ, if I can just apply myself more perfectly. If I can get the keys, if I can find a shortcut, if I can avoid the things that slow most other people down, I can get further, faster, and more pleasing to God if I do that. All I need to know is the tools to get there. Now, that whole premise is what caused the collapse of the Garden of Eden. Because what she was being promised is a shortcut by convincing her that there was more that she had not yet got. And I think as Christians and many Christian churches, instead of working to do what God has called us to do and helping you discover what it is that God's called you to do, what do? We get in competition. I guarantee if I had a show of hands here, your reading of the Bible is very few and far between. And you'd say to me, I'm busy all the time. I know you're busy. That's what Satan want to keep you busy, 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 busy. And so at the end of all that, you don't know what the word says for yourself. So you come to a house like this so I can teach you that. I can't teach you the things that the Lord wants you to know as an individual, because he's the one that instructs you what to learn. You follow me? So every one of us has an obligation, to make sure that we know, A, what we hear, and B, who we're hearing it from. Huh? It says, in James especially, that James and Jude, there are a lot of people who go about teaching things that are error, and after we listen to them and take them into our heart as truth, then we propagate that error and wound a whole lot more people. It's exponential, you see. All right, so here comes Jeremiah, and he's going to go to the prophets. And I want you to follow now, just pretty carefully, what he says, what God says to him, because I'm going to say the same things to you, and then we've got a couple more scriptures, and then we'll send you home. The vessel that came out of clay was, and it says, the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. Now listen to this carefully, because you may not have seen this before, and if you have, good, because I hadn't seen it before. So he made it again into another vessel. It doesn't say that he took that vessel and repaired it. See that? Is it on a screen somewhere? All right, good. New leader. But the jar he was making didn't turn out as he had hoped. Not good. Original text doesn't say that. It doesn't bring judgment against the vessel that was already in God's hands. It just says that God found a problem with it. Do you see that? He says, and the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. He is trying to make something out of this clay, but the vessel is already cracked and marred, just like every one of us. So if the master starts a work, he's telling the prophet, I've started a work. This vessel is on the wheel, all right? But I inspect it. And each one of these vessels that he inspects, everyone in this room, everyone that's watching, each vessel he inspects has sometimes similar faults, but not identical faults. So here comes Jeremiah, and God says to him, take note, what's on the wheel was marred, and look what he says. He says, the vessel made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. Didn't say he'd made it. The vessel on the wheel, he's looking, and he sees a problem with it. And so he made it again into another vessel. He took what was there, the clay, right? Didn't say he threw the clay out. It says that that vessel was broken down to its constituencies again, its basics, and then it was reformed into something different. Follow me? Now, the point I wanted you to understand, and what God wanted him to understand, what you to get today, is that you were birthed with a purpose in God. Absolutely. You had a destination and a purpose in God. Now, unless, listen carefully, unless that crack, that mar, that dint that the world has placed in you as a newborn believer, unless that dint or that mar or that crack is repaired, the vessel's no good. Do we figure that out? It's not that the vessel itself is no good, it's no good for use, right? Now, if we think about that, then now we're talking about the sovereignty of God. Every vessel is in the hand of God. God has the right, absolute, supreme right to make changes to that vessel, does he not? And yet if we read on, we'll discover that without the willingness of that vessel to be changed by the potter, the vessel will stay cracked, marred, and unusable for anything of any particular value. I'll read this to you. Next verse, please. Give me the next verse. Just keep going. Verse 5. Then the word of the Lord came to me and said, next verse, house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter? Why won't you let me fix you? He's talking to the prophet, see. And it says the Lord, look, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so you are also in my hand, house of Israel. Sound right so far? Next verse. The instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom to pluck it up, to pull it down and to destroy it, the instant I speak it, if that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil. See? God is sovereign, and yet he cannot force this people to soften their heart concerning him. So how does he do it? He allows the adversary to come against them so that the adversary's assignments, the wickedness of their enemies, the heart, the cruelness of their enemies, will turn them back to God, because then they will see and know that only God can get us out of this mess. Amen. So what they do is they start honoring God as a sovereign God again. That's what he's saying. And he says, if they do that and return from their evil, I will relent of the disaster that I thought or considered to bring upon it. Verse 9. The instant I speak concerning a nation, concerning a kingdom, to build it and to plant it, if it does evil in my sight, or continues to do, or are unwilling to let me fix what's wrong with them, right? If they're unwilling to allow me to do that, and they don't obey my voice, then I will relent concerning the good with which I said I would benefit it. Verse 11, Now therefore speak to the men of Judah and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, saying, thus saith the Lord, behold, I am fashioning a disaster. The prophet came with a warning. God has done nothing against you practically yet, because you are in his hand. However, you're not letting him recreate you into something of value. He can't use you in his house until you allow him to do something that changes you from where you are now into something of value. Does it make sense? If that's the case, he said, now God is beginning to fashion an idea that's going to bring disaster into your camp. Behold, I'm fashioned as that, devising a plan against you. Return now, everyone, from his evil way, and make your ways and your doings good. I could give you a one-liner here that might help you as we're progressing with this whole idea. The whole purpose of this is to get you out from under wrong thinking when it comes to where am I headed with my Christianity. God promised us, the Lord promised us, that before his return there would be a great falling away. It's called the apostasy, the apostasia. The apostasia is nothing more, no more, no less than people giving up on their destiny in God. And they get there in a very slow fashion. We've all been close to it. Some of us jumped over it and come back by the grace of God. But the reason we get there is we dethrone God from our own heart and we put ourselves back on the throne again. And we start doing what pleases us, when it pleases us, to whoever it pleases us to do it to, regardless of any consequences, because by this time, the Holy Spirit hasn't departed from you, because that's a very rare event. But what has happened is you become hardened to the things of God. Now, Jesus talked a lot about that. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do a thing I ask you to do? You know why they didn't do a thing he asked them to do? Because they were flat out doing everything they wanted to do. Right? So the key to being to backsliding is to become selfish again. And I didn't realize, but getting around a lot of people as I have recently, a lot of them are just plumb wore out selfish. And they do whatever they want to do because there's no correction factor. They are not yet even in the potter's hands. They have no idea there's something wrong with them. They think something wrong with you. Are you nuts? You worship who? You pray for what? You believe God heals and delivers? What? Provides finances? You're totally nuts. Well, what do? Oh, we go to the bank. Or we use our credit cards. Like a lot of Christians are tapped out on their credit cards because you trust them more than you trust God. And you're not going to wait for anything, are you? So the point I'm trying to make to you is that the selfishness that's in the world is starting to affect Christians, and they're starting to think to themselves, well, it works for them. I need a new car. Well, every 5 minutes there's some guy on television wanting you to buy one. The down payment now is more than the car used to be 20 years ago. Huh? Well, if you can't do that, go down to Happy Jack. He'll be glad to sell you some worn-out piece of junk at 26% interest, but I just got to have a car. I've been praying and God didn't do it. Do you need a car? Absolutely. Do you need it to find your way to the house of the Lord? Yeah, take your family? Yeah, you just need it for work? Yeah. Then why wouldn't God want you to have a car? See, that thought doesn't... Well, he does, and so I'm going to go get it. But how are we going to accomplish your dream of a car? Any way I can. I'll borrow it, use a credit card, type whatever I need to do to get what I want, then I'm having to do it. And then when the payments get too much for you to afford, or you have to sell the car and they're going to repossess it, then you cry out to God. So what I'm saying is God has his way of getting two things accomplished at the same time. But you've got to let him show you that you have a need. Go over to, did I give you another scripture yet? Oh yeah, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God, the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly place. Well, what good are spiritual blessings? No good at all, unless I can bring them to earth. Is that right? What he's saying there is a now listen to me carefully, because I know what I'm talking about. I know I sound like I just fell off the back of a turnip truck to some of you. But this stuff works. It's been working for me for over 30 years. The Lord says, I have blessed you with every spiritual blessing in Christ, right? You know what it says here? See? Because we are united with Christ, spiritual blessings, because we are united with Christ, and he paid the price for us to have those spiritual. But what good is it if I can't eat it? And I can't be married to it. I can't wear it. I can't drive it. See? I can't give God thanks for something that's in the spirit. Well, I can, but that's something people don't learn very early. But once I have understood that God wants me to be a happy person, God wants me to be a happily married person, God wants me to have enough in my pocket so that your wife can take it from you. Yeah. There ought to be. See, we read about this all the time. We say, well, God said that, you know, you can have more than enough, and I'm supremely blessed, and I have an abundance of it. But we don't. And the reason we don't is because we don't have this understanding, even revelation, of the fact that God is not broke, see, and that he wants to make us prosperous and happy. Beloved above all things, I desire that you prosper and be in good health. He's talking to Gaius, and we talked about that Wednesday. And be in good health even as your soul prospers. The soul's the problem. Once we get the mind, the will, the imaginations, the memories, and all those things under control and used in this earth realm where God gave us to use them, they are no good in the spiritual realm at all. Your feelings won't get blessings from heaven, but my faith will. And so this is how it operates. Once I truly believe that God is a benefactor, that he loves me, period, that he's not mad at me all the time, he's glad at me all the time, that there is nothing that the enemy can do can stop me having the things that Jesus said go along with a blessed life. Food, transport. He said, look at the birds of the air, they neither reap nor sow, you heavenly Father. Aren't you of more value than a bird or a sparrow? Come on. So Jesus went out of his way to say, your problem is not the fact that God doesn't move mountains. Your problem is that your eye is on the mountain. See what I'm saying? So if Christianity offers those kinds of blessings, but they fast discovered in the 50s here in the United States after the Second World War when most people were broke, they fast discovered that if we can nail this into people, they'll become very easy to get to help us to build this and take offerings for that. And then after that started to weary out a little bit, then it got into the healing crusades. But God was in all of them. God said, yes, I'll heal and deliver. Yes, I will make provision for you. Yes, I can provide houses and lands and cars. See, and after this physical life, eternal life in heaven. See, yes, that's fine. But we've got to believe that, but the church doesn't believe it anymore. They say they do, but why are we so in debt? Why do we have more credit card piled up, more Christian marriages failing than ever before? Because we're taking the world's way of looking at things, you see. So right from the very beginning, the effort has been made by the enemy to undermine our understanding that God is sovereign, and our way of getting the sovereign blessings of God from heaven to earth is by believing them in our heart, by speaking them in our normal day language, instead of speaking the things that are as if they're not, speak the things that are not as if they are. You see? If we want it, we want it now. No, faith doesn't work on your timetable. It works on God's timetable. I said, well, how long is it going to take for me to get my faith where God will please it? A faith that pleases God. Probably about 30 seconds after you have decided that you're going to quit. Because God knows the limit of your faith. He said, you wouldn't be put through this test if you didn't have the ability and the understanding and the knowledge to pass it. When Jesus said, you're going to the other side, you're going to the other side. He didn't say, you may not have a boat when you get there, but you're going to the other side. And then he demonstrated sovereignty over natural things by walking on the very waves that were sinking the boat the disciples were in complaining about. He said, check me out, boys. I'm walking on what's killing you. So what does that tell you? It should have told them that the Lord himself is sovereign. He is sovereign over the earth. He walked on the waves. You follow what I'm saying? So the mentality, the issue we're having is that we really have lost the view of God as sovereign. And as his child, you have a right to ask a sovereign father to provide the things that you currently don't have because you're trusting in him. The word says he has to honor that. Amen. How he does, it's up to him. I scribbled down here when we're talking about, you know, the potter's house and so forth and so on. I wrote down that the final result rests with man. The final issue when it comes to sovereignty rests with man and not with God. Why? Because we have to submit ourselves totally to God's plan and purpose before He can step in and put his thumb in the part of your life that's messed up. Oh, sorry, let's go back to Ephesians here. Are you getting anything out of this?
Yeah.
All right, well, that'll help me. So it says in verse 3, with every spirit, verse 4, please. Just as he chose, now listen to this, just as he chose us before the foundation of the world. Now it sounds like another Jeremiah thing, doesn't it? But notice here, this isn't he talking about a prophet, he's talking about you. Here the man of God, Paul, is talking about the members of his congregation. And he refers to them as you, just as he chose us. Right here in front of me, right? As he chose us in Christ or in God before the foundation of the world. That we should be holy and without blame before him in love. It's the love that makes you holy and without blame. See? You receive Christ. Christ is love. And therefore, there can be no hatred in the heart of a believer who is trusting in the love of God. The love of Jesus Christ is the same love that motivates us to forgive others. And to forgive ourselves if it comes to that. See? Just think about God as the incarnation of love. He is love. It doesn't say he practices love. He is love. See? So when you approach God, who is sovereign, knowing that he loves you sovereignly, then what is there, as Paul said earlier in Romans, what is there that can separate me from the love of God? If he's sovereign and he loves me beyond my ability to love back, see? And he loves me because of his son. He sees me through the blood of his son. See? And I'm cleansed by the time. When God sees me, by the time it's filtered by the blood of the lamb, it's white. I'm white. I'm clean. See? But I have to ask for that. But because he's sovereign, he can grant anything. And everything he created is subject to him. It says that he created the destroyer to destroy, but no weapon formed against you. You see what I'm saying? So Satan is a created being, and so you can't defeat him. If he gets into this into your head and convinces you that you've done something that can't be forgiven, or convinces you that you're a failure and a flake, and that you can't progress fast enough to, you know, I'm so much in debt now, kind of the world sucked me in and just took all my money, and now I'm on the verge of, I say, if he can get you that far down where you can no longer see your way out, then you defeat yourself. But when it comes to God, he is sovereign. Satan cannot defeat the creator. Why? Because he was created by him. Satan's not interested in the areas in which God is now your Lord. He's interested in the parts that's not where he's not your Lord, where his sovereignty is not your choice. Where I choose to do something out of the will of God, God cannot stop me doing it. He can give you a lot of prompting. It's hard to kick against the pricks, but when it comes down to it, if I want to sin, look out of the way. I'm going to sin big. Was God willing to forgive me? Yes, he'd rather you didn't, of course, because it has repercussion. See? Sin has repercussion. We all know that. But the landing can be soft. You don't have to land on your head, you know. You did wrong, there's going to be a price for that. Sooner someone else or you are going to have to pay a price for that, so you won't forget it. But I'm sovereign and I can do anything. I can forgive anything. I can be anywhere at once. I know all things. I'm not missing it. I mean, how do you beat that? So Satan knows he can't beat that. The only way he can beat it is if you let Satan do it. If you believe a lie and that lie becomes a surrogate truth so that you can do something which you know in your heart is displeasing to God, Satan can't touch you. And if he does, he can't kill you. Read Job again. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ, he said, I called you a son before you knew you had a daddy. Isn't that awesome? Well, why aren't more people saved? Because there's a lot of preachers that are retiring now who ought to be the vehicle by which God can, you know, preach the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the kingdom isn't preached that much anymore, in case you haven't noticed. Right? Because it's like some woman said the other day, really good. I was watching something on the God channel, but she was really, really good. A woman at a woman's convention. The Scottish gal used to work with 700 Club. She must have been younger there, I think, because she's a lot older now. She's 60 now, yeah. But she preached her little britches off. I mean, awesome. And one of it, she said, I finally got to the point where I realized it's not about you. It's about Jesus. Okay? You're not Jesus. You can't save, you can't heal, and you can't deliver. But on the preaching of the gospel, once people get it into their mind and in their heart that God is sovereign, then he can do something. What if Jesus, see what Jesus said, believe ye, I'm able to do this thing. What was he really saying? Do you believe I'm God? Now, a lot of people are drawn to the platform or drawn to the altar because they have a need. You know, physical need, emotionally, financially, they all come for prayer. But Jesus was identifying here. A lot of people come to me, but not everybody gets what they come for. Even today, I can tell you, you know, the ratio of people getting touched by God in the American houses of worship has gone down the tubes. Because I could ask the same question. I won't say believe I can do that because I'm not the healer, Jesus is. But I could just as easily say, do you believe God can do this? Well, they can believe God can do it, but do they believe that God will do it for me? In order for that to happen, they have to have a revelation of the fact that he is sovereign. Amen. And there's so much opposition coming at us today. From our workplace, from the school places, wherever we may be, there's so many people who are negative and the world system's pumping it at you over the television or radio all the time. The music, same thing all the time. It's pumping everything other than the sovereignty of God. So now we get to a point, if he's a sovereign God, what do I need to do in order to get his sovereignty to work for me? You've got to agree with God. You have to submit to the oversight of God. And to the areas in which you fail to do that, you're still sovereign in those areas. And God is limited into what he can do to change your opinion other than circumstances. If you're having trouble with money, there's something wrong with your position on the sovereignty of God when it comes to your finances. Either money is your God or God is your God, but you can't have both. Jesus said that really plainly in three different places. So if I want to be able to say to Satan, I take authority over you, lack of my finances, I take authority over you, my stingy boss, I pray for him, Lord, you'll bless him. But I have authority to speak life into my finances only if I have given the sovereignty over my finances to God. Then it's he that does the good work and not me. Are you following me? It becomes God then who has the opportunity to do what he needs to do because I've given him the right to do it. So this predestination thing starts kicking in. Follow me with this, just real quickly. We're almost finished. Having predestined us as adoption by sons, and remember, a son has a right to the inheritance. Yes. Legally, every son has a right to whatever the parents possess. In these cases, whatever the father or the patriarch possessed, the firstborn son automatically got it. He could have been a blithering idiot, you know? But nevertheless, if he was firstborn son, then he got it. Unless, of course, he was willing to give it away, as Jacob did Esau. So if he has the right to be called a son, then the inheritance is yours. A servant has no right to the inheritance. Is that correct? Therefore, my relationship to God cannot be one as a servant to his master, but rather one who is submitted to God as his sovereign Lord. And as such, I become one of his adopted sons and therefore have every right to ask for a blessing or an inheritance. Follow me? If I try to work my way there like Martha did, then I have no inheritance. I cannot put a claim or a demand upon an almighty God if my claim is based on my servanthood. It has to be based on my admission and my submission to God's sovereignty. If two people walk into a room and one's anointed of God and is submitted to God after being trained for years and years, in my case of being, you know, learnt to do stupid things and fall down and repent and come back up again. I walk into a room in which a woman has a demon. Another person walks in the room, has been through Bible school, but has never submitted totally to God. Which one has the authority? The one who has submitted himself totally to God. How will we know that? He's anointed. We ought to allow people to go through the anointed test when we go and visit a house of God. The reason I put all those things on there was not point to me. That God operates in this house as a healing God, as a delivering God, you see, as a merciful, graceful God. I talk about it, comes on me now. See? So if that's there, then you have a right to expect that. Somebody said one time, no Holy Ghost, no Jesus. No signs, no wonders, no Jesus. See? Because Jesus was able to cast out, to heal and to deliver, even to restore life to the dead because of, and I know you're going to ask, but this is me, because of his absolute 100% dedication to God as sovereign. See? He says, if you don't believe me for my words, do it by my works. Believe me because of the works. And the works that I do, I don't do them. The works that I do because my Father told me to do them. Absolute obedience, you see. And our connection is no longer because we're perfect as Jesus was, but our connection is through Christ, you see. Through Christ. Through Christ, our faith can be encouraged to the point where we can understand and begin to believe in our hearts and our minds the sovereignty of God. And predestination is part of that. What are you predestined to? Failure? You know, lack of success in everything you put your hand to? Something I say? Yeah. What can we base it on? Only on the fact that I am unable, but God is able. See? I'm not perfect, but God is perfect. I didn't live a perfect life, but my Savior Jesus did. You see? And if you can get rid of these and the antithesis, the negativity that floods into the mind of every believer and start taking matters into your own hands, immediately I have done that, immediately you've done that, we've jumped off the potter's wheel and now we are an independent piece of clay on the ground, good for nothing. Real quick, back up here. I'm going to go through verse 8. Having predestined us to adoption of the sons, la 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 la. Verse 6, please. To the praise of the glory of grace by which he made us accepted in the beloved. His grace makes a way where nothing else can. God says, I want you to have it. Just get a handle on this and begin to speak, act, and think like I'm telling you to, and then your faith will kick in and you'll start seeing more of the interaction of God. And it says in verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Verse 8, which he made us all to abound toward us in all wisdom and in all prudence. Two more verses. Having made known to us the mystery of his will according to the good pleasure which he purposed in himself. He wants you to get it. He wants you to have it. He wants you to remember it. He wants you to take advantage of the grace that he has for you. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, that he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are in the earth. Final verse 11. In him also we have obtained an inheritance. See, I just talked about the inheritance. Being predestined. Your inheritance is predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his own will. In other words, you can't lose. You can't lose as long as you can get a handle on the whole idea of the sovereignty of your God. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 2, yeah, that's right, verse 19. Nevertheless, the solid foundation of God stands having this seal. And when it says that, you better listen up. The Lord knows those who belong to him. The Lord knows those that are his. What does that mean? I'll put it another way. The Lord knows those who have received him as sovereign. What about the others? He knows them too, but he doesn't know them the same way. More importantly, you don't know him the same way either. You say, where did he get that faith from? From the day he finally understood that God is all-knowing, all-powerful, all-seeing. God is all and all in all. In the beginning, God. And it says, let everyone who names the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Verse 20. But in a great house, listen carefully, in a great house there are not only vessels. Now we're getting back to the jar again. We're going back to the potter's house. He says, in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honor and some for dishonor. Now, before we go to the next verse, now you jumped it. Before I go to the next verse, I want you to ask yourself, in any house, who determines what vessels are used for what? The owner of the house. I would say my wife, I would say. If you've got a house and you've got certain vessels made of wood, others made of gold and silver, each one of those vessels is used for a particular purpose. Is that correct? The interesting part here is that the Lord says, even in a great house, there are still vessels of clay. Some for honor, some for dishonor. What I'm trying to tell you, in the house of God, he gets to choose, not you, not you. He gets to use which vessels get used for what purpose. Stop beating your brains out trying to be something that God is not in the business of creating. Now, I'll explain it to you. The very next verse says that we can purge ourselves by avoiding things of dishonor. In other words, the process on the master's wheel stops when you stop. But here's the good part that'll keep you on the wheel. The part that keeps you on the wheel and keeps me on the wheel, that keeps me wanting God to reveal to me things that I didn't even know about myself that are holding me back from being a more useful vessel in His kingdom, is not because I've chosen to be a gold vessel. Some folks, God needs to have some folks in the house that do menial tasks and menial duties. As far as the Lord is concerned, when you give Him the right to begin to mold you and make you, you do two things. Number one, I say, God is sovereign. You do in my life whatever you want to do, and I'll try to keep myself out of myself. Amen. Keep myself out of the way. Yes, sir. All right? All I need, put me in a group of people, preach me the gospel, let me get my nose into the Word of God, let me get the Holy Spirit operational in my life and telling me, speaking to me, talking to me. Once those things begin to operate, then I'm on the wheel. I say, God, do whatever you need to do to make me a gold vessel. He won't move. Well, make me a silver vessel then. He won't move. Make me an evangelist. Make me a prophet. Make me a pastor. He won't move. All right, Lord, if you're going to be sovereign, then I release my right to myself and you make me whatever you want to make me. Now he moves. Now the wheel begins to spin, see? So wherever we finish up according to predestination, it may not be where you thought you're going to be. It may not be geographically where you thought or married to the person you thought. But ultimately, if I am submitted to God, God's plans and purposes according to His predestination in Christ Jesus, they will be accomplished in your life, and that will equal serenity. It will equal peace. Now, we're talking more and more about this, but the most powerful thing that we can get out of this final bit of scripture is this one in verse 21. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from the latter. Now, if you just back a little bit, it says from honorable use or dishonorable use. If you cleanse yourself from having to be a potty vessel, dishonorable use. They were made out of clay. They weren't made out of gold for obvious reasons. Amen? There's a lamp that I have that I got in Israel. When over there, they're very cheap. They're the little oil lamps. They find them by the thousands. They were very cheap to buy, and they were used just to put oil in and light to bring light to the house. A very meager vessel. But there's thousands and thousands and thousands of those, and there's very few of the gold ones, which all the guys are trying to find. Right? He says, if you'll cleanse yourself from the things that make you impure, isn't that interesting? It says that God won't cleanse them unless you allow Him to do it. Do you understand that? If you're stuck in your spiritual growth and you're in a place that doesn't prompt you to allow God's sovereignty to enter your life and to dig out those thorns that are deep in your heart, if you don't allow that to happen, Satan can keep you clogged down, bogged down for the rest of your life, and you'll never accomplish the thing that God wants from you. It only starts the very split second I say, here am I, Lord. Do with me what you want to do with me. Make me into what you want me to make. Help me to get the revelation today that I am exactly where you want me to be, but if I'm not where you want me to be tomorrow, I release you, Lord, to do in my life today what will change my life tomorrow. And then be happy with it. Be happy in the situations in which you are. That's what Paul said. I had to get this one too, that I am content to be in the situation that I am right now. How do I get content with my finances? Give God the right over your money. Now, I said, when I say that now, you have to get yourself in a position where you're using wisdom. You don't throw your money away or give it away. In the case where you said the rich young ruler, it says that his problem was his money was his God. And the rich young ruler was on the potter's wheel and said to the potter, I want to have eternal life. How do I get there? Jesus said, do this. Oh, I've done all that. Now help me. Spin the wheel. Make me who I'm supposed to be. And God, Jesus, said to him, okay, I'll get ready to spin the wheel now. My foot's right on the thing to push it to start you spinning. But before I do that, give all your money to the poor. That was all it took, Bubba. And all Jesus did was answer his question. I can't be sovereign over you and while your money is still sovereign in your heart. If you're not willing to trust me with nothing, and you've got a lot, then you're going to have to become nothing so that you can trust yourself with me and I can trust you. See how hard it is for a rich man to enter into the kingdom. Well, I don't know, in America, a lot of rich people here, you don't think you're rich, but you really are compared to most folks. So people tell me, well, how can I make sure that God will always come to my aid and my rescue when I'm broke? Well, there's a big answer to that. But the bottom line is trust him with all of your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your might. And love your neighbor as yourself. And if you can figure out how your money has gotten such a grip on you that you find yourself counting out the pennies and the dimes to pay tithes or give offerings, then it's already got a grip on you. The only way to break loose of that is to abandon yourself into the care and taking of God. And I suggest people start with a tithe and they double up on it. When you get an opportunity to give first fruits, as many of you do, you've seen the blessing in that, that breaks people free a lot of times. Amen. Just the ability to be liberal with your money. Not foolish, but liberal with your money. Amen?